Hello guys, how's it going? My name is Zalarin. We got massive updates in the 905 PTR with some great changes. The Blizzard's actually making it for classes as well as legendaries. In fact, there's actually a lot more for us to cover. And we have the gearing, the raiding, the dungeons, and what Blizzard is doing with Valor Points. We even have more in-depth stuff to talk about rogues, but in this video, I really want to go over some of the changes that Blizzard is making for 905 for classes as well as legendaries. This is probably going to be a longer video, but I wanted to dive into every one of these changes and how impactful they might be towards every one of these class changes out there. Are these legendaries looking like something to boost the DPS of a spec, and is Blizzard trying to shift the meta forward? That's what we're going to be talking about today. So let's dive into this long but yet exciting video on classes as well as the legendaries that are getting changed so far in 905. We'll start with the class changes with Demon Hunters, where their Unbound Chaos Talent damage is increased by 500% instead of 300. Hard to tell if this is going to become the meta talent to go to, but it should make it a little bit stronger in the row, and maybe there could be a potentially a momentum build further down the line for Demon Hunters to take advantage of Unbound Chaos. Restoration Druids are getting a bit of a buff, with reduced periodic healing increased by 12% and wild growth getting increased by 7%. You have a mana change happening with Mist Rivers as well, where Revivify and Renewing Mist will cost a little bit less mana. This is actually a pretty good buff for Mist Rivers, not enough maybe to make them super meta, but they are one of the healers that can literally turn the mana into health. So they are the one caster that can literally spend their mana faster than any other healer, and this should help them in order to get more Vivifies and Renew and Mist out in order to heal their party. Earlier we saw Holy Shock getting its mana cost increased, mostly for PvP purposes I'd say, but also affects PvE. And also Ardent Defector's heal effect will now apparently have a visual to it. I haven't seen what the visual looks like on PTR yet, I don't know if it's actually been implemented yet, but that should be pretty exciting to see. Disc Priest, as we talked about before, Spirit Shell is getting nerfed. I still don't think it's going to make Discipline Priest less wanted inside of raids. I think it's still going to dominate, but Spirit Shell nerf just, I think, is more for the tuning for future raid tiers. Then you have Holy Divine Hymn getting slightly changed, where at first glance it looks like it's a healing nerf, but I think it's overall a buff. Normally, during Divine Hymn, any ally affected by that spell takes 10% more healing. But that means for Holy Priest, they never get advantage of that 10% healing buff. So you would have a Holy Priest use Divine Hymn while another healer heals the group and has their heals amplified. This change makes it that every time an ally gets healed by Divine Hymn, their healing is increased by 4% instead of 10, but that 4% now stacks over 5 times as they continue getting healed by Divine Hymn. Instead of having an 8 second duration, now it's a 15 second duration, so it lasts far longer. So a Holy Priest now can use Divine Hymn and then can use the fruits of their labor, that 4% stacking 5 times, to heal their allies for more healing, which should hopefully make AoE healing for groups for Holy, maybe for Mythic Pluses or Raids, a lot more consistent. We got some changes for Rogues, primarily with Assassination, where Cut to the Chase returns, where in Venom extends the duration of your slice and dice by 3 seconds per combo point spent. This is a pretty major one, and I will have a separate video talking about Assassination Rogues later down the line. Slice and Dice Ring 2, where Slice and Dice increase your energy regen from Assassination, has been removed completely, and Venom's Wounds now restores 1 extra energy per bleed tick, which is also kind of nice. Expect a much bigger video talking more in depth of rogue changes in the next video, most likely. Shaman's got a few changes where Chain Lightning will actually do a little bit more damage, and so will Lightning Shield. I think Blizzard saw that a lot of Shamans are freely swapping out of Lightning Shield for something like a Earth Shield, but Lightning Shield should do a little bit of damage back to the enemy, so they increase it by 415%. I wonder if that'll be enough for more Shamans to consider using Lightning Shield for PvP if it does enough damage. We have a couple changes for Restoration as well as Elemental. We'll first talk about Elemental. Earthshock damage increased by 30%. Earthquake damage increased by 70%. Lava Beam inside of the Ascendance also increased by 35%, since that's basically your Chain Lightning. But for both Restoration and Elemental, Lava Burst damage is reduced by 10. It could be that an employee over at Blizzard might have been queuing arenas into a bunch of Shamans playing the Necrolord Covenant and getting bursted by a bunch of Lava Bursts. But I think this is most likely a PvE / PvP change, mostly for the scaling of Lava Burst for future content. They're nerfing it by 10 because otherwise the ability would outscale going forward, so they're just trying to nip it in the butt right now so it doesn't really break any kind of scaling in the future. For enhancement shamans, we have Lava Lash doing 40% more damage. I'm actually a huge fan of that because it feels like with the playstyle for enhancement right now, Lava Lash is pretty low in the priority. So making it more of a priority ability to put on cooldown feels right from the good old version of the old school enhancement from like Pandaria or Cataclysm. Then Stormkeeper has gotten changed where now it'll increase the damage of your Chain Lightning by 300% instead of Lightning Bolt by 150%. I think the reason they did this is to make Stormkeeper more of a Cleave E talent, very similar to the rest of the talents in that same row. So they do make it so where Chain Lightning does more damage, actually equivalent to a fully maelstromed 5 stack Lightning Bolt. I think this makes this talent even better for AoE damage for Enhancement Shamans, and that's what really what Blizzard was trying to do. But it still can be used for single target if you end up going for a more Lightning Bolt slash Chain Lightning build. It has a lot more cleave to it, and I feel like this talent should be a little bit stronger since Stormkeeper is literally in that cleave E row. A small but important change to Demonology Warlocks. Summon Dreadstalkers, Demonic Tyrant, Vile Fiend, Nether Portal Demons, and Grimoire Felguard will now listen to primary pet commands. All those pets have had a mind of their own and have done very stupid things in PvP before. We watched it a billion times in duels, trust me. And compared to, let's say, Unholy Death Knight pets, which are more or less smart and will listen to main pets' commands, finally, Demonology Warlock pets will have a bit of a brain, or at least have a bit more control for the Warlock over what those pets do. So this is a pretty big one for those Warlocks that felt like your pets are just doing their own thing and are not listening to what you tell them. We also got a couple changes for a few classes when it comes to your Covenant abilities. In fact, on this channel, we've covered a lot of these Covenant changes in before and talked about how they're going to impact the playstyle. So I'll have a link down for that video in the description if I remember to set it there, because I sometimes do these videos at 5 in the morning, but I will hopefully have a link down below, and if I don't, please let me know. But let's talk about some of the Covenant changes that won't be covered in that video, because this is some new stuff that we haven't seen before. So let's take a look at some of the new Covenant things that Blizzard is going to be implementing. First of all, Vengeance Demon Hunters, Elysian Decree, your Hunt, as well as Sinful Brand have all been nerfed by 10%. While Father of the Flame has been left untouched. It does go through a whole new change and it is going to be playing differently, but it looks like Elysian Decree, the Hunt, and Sinful Brand are too good, or Father to the Flame is just not good enough. So they're going to be nerfing the other Covenants in order to make him a little bit more even to one another. I think that's going to be a very interesting change, and I wonder how many Demon Hunters will be more likely to swap off of Kyrian and try other Covenants, even the one for the Momojaxian variety. Next we have Adaptive Swarm, where it still will do more damage and more healing, and will still increase the periodic effects of damage over time on enemies, except for Balanced Druids. That damage increase for damage over time will be increased to 35 instead of 25, to hopefully allow Balanced Druids more of a dot-focused playstyle. Then we have Monks of Venthyr variety. Fallen Order's Fallen Tiger as well as Ox Adepts have had their stats increased by 20%, so potentially a full pet build for Monks could be a possibility going forward, depending on how hard these Fallen Tiger and Ox Adepts hit. The Rogue ability Flagellation has been redesigned quite a bit, and there's going to be a whole separate video talking about how Flagellation will now work for a Rogue special video. But if you want to know the basics, they're going to make it so that you don't have to press Flagellation a second time. You just put it up as a debuff on the enemy and it will just do its thing. It'll now not cost any energy at all. It'll still have a 1.5 minute cooldown. It'll last 12 seconds and it'll do far more damage. Initial damage is going to be a lot higher, and for every comm point you spend in a finisher while Flagellation is on an enemy target, it's going to do far more damage and grant you far more haste. A lot easier of an ability that's very similar to the other Rogue abilities of Press It and Forget It. Then we have Shamans with a couple new changes. First of all, the Primordial Wave Enhancement Shaman Lightning Bolt now does more damage. It deals 150% damage instead of 100, and the Chain Harvest damage for Elemental Shaman as well as Restoration Shaman has been increased, the damage and healing, by 15%. The Warlock Covenant ability of Decimating Bolt has also got buffed a little bit. Now it does 100% bonus damage to the enemy instead of up to 60%, making it a slightly stronger damaging ability during those execute windows. Now let's get into the legendaries, and there's a lot of legendaries for us to take a look at. First of all, Blood Death Knight. Crimson Rune Weapon will now provide you 5 bone shield charges when you use your Dancing Rune Weapon, and it'll also reduce the cooldown of your Dancing Rune Weapon when one of those bone shield charges is consumed by 5 seconds instead of 3. That means a lot more weapon uses, so a lot more possibility for Blood Death Knights to potentially deal with physical damage. Gorfin's Domination, your vampiric blood will now generate 45 runic power, which means a free death strike as soon as you use it. Additionally, your heart strike will also reduce the remaining cooldown of vampiric blood, so potentially more vampiric bloods in overall playstyle. Vampiric Aura, vampiric blood will now grant you 5% leech for more survivability. Its duration is decreased by 3 seconds, which is also nice. Additionally, vampiric blood affects all party members, that has been unchanged. This looks like overall quite a lot of buffs to Blood Death Knight that actually could potentially be good. Asking somebody who plays Blood DK, they said that these buffs actually look quite substantial and could potentially make any of those legendaries really solid. Or if we ever play a dual wield legendary playstyle where we have 2 LEGO effects instead of 1, all these effects will just go to make Blood DK almost unstoppable as a tank. Then you have the reanimated Shambler doing slightly more damage and getting slightly more procs for Unholy. A legendary that doesn't really get too much play, so it looks like Blizzard is buffing one of the lesser used legendaries. We have Havoc Demon Hunters with Burning Wound, where Demon's Bite will now leave quite a big damage over time ability in comparison to its previous damage, and also make the enemy take more damage from Immolation Aura. Maybe this could be a potentially decent legendary for some close quarter Klee fights where you could use Demon's Bite on a couple enemies and make that Immolation Aura provide extra damage over time. But who knows, it's hard to tell if this is going to be a good change or not, as again, it's another legendary that doesn't get too much play. Both Havoc and Vengeance get a buff to their Dark Lair Boon, or is it a buff? I guess kinda is. It is a bit of an RNG legendary, but if it works, I guess it could be good. For Havoc, Ibeam has a 40% chance to not incur cooldown and refund 30 Fury. Vile Devastation has a 40% chance to not incur its cooldown and refund 50 Fury. It's a bit of an RNG legendary, and it's really hard to tell if those are going to be all that good, but I guess if you get lucky with the procs, it could be pretty good for Demon Hunters. Then we got Feral Druids with Cat's Eye Curio, giving you a little bit more energy when you clear cast abilities. I remember that one being kind of a favorite of mine back in the day of Alpha and Beta, so I wonder if this will make this legendary kind of decent. Then we also got Frenzy Band, where your common point generator abilities will now reduce the cooldown of Incarn as well as Berserk by 0.3 instead of 0.2 seconds. Not much of a buff there. But the bleed damage they'll do during Incarn or Berserk is now increased to 150% of the damage for 8 seconds instead of 100. I don't remember this legendary being all that good back in the beta, and something tells me I doubt it's going to be all that good, but maybe I'll be proven wrong. Finally, for Druids, we have Verdant Infusion, where Swiftmand no longer consumes heals over time, will also extend those heals instead by 10 seconds instead of 8. I don't really know what the best legendary is for Druids, but if you're running Verdant Infusion, that's going to see a buff in 905. If you're a Beastmaster Hunter, you got a lot of legendary buffs. Dire Command now has a 35% chance to summon a Dire Beast. The Cobra Sting legendary, Cobra Shot, has a 50% chance to make a next skill command not consume focus. Eridan War Order makes it so Barb Shot does more damage, and applying Barb Shot resets the cooldown of kill command completely. Rylax Stalker Spears and Fangs makes Bestial Wrath while active, your pet's critical damage is increased by 40% instead of 20. That seems like a lot of buffs, but when you look at the sims for Beastmaster Hunters, all their spec-specific legendaries have actually simmed pretty behind compared to the Soulforge, Tar Trap, the Flare legendary. So maybe this will make these a little bit more competitive. Maybe with better gear in the next tier with scaling, you might be able to allow Beastmaster Hunters to actually start running these legendaries with higher crit numbers. But I noticed another thing for Beastmaster Hunter legendaries, a lot of them are percent chances for summon to happen or summon to proc, or at least most of them are. So being a lot of RNG heavy legendaries probably makes them super inconsistent, right? Small updates for Marksman with Eagle Talons True Focus, extending duration of your True Shot by 5 extra seconds. And Surgeon Shots does 10% more damage for your Rapid Fires, so maybe you can make a Rapid Fire legendary playstyle. For mages, we'll start with Arcane Harmony, increasing the damage of your Arcane Barrage slightly and stack it for a little bit more. One of the legendaries that doesn't really get too much play if you ever even see an Arcane inside of raids. For fire mages, we have Molten Skyfall, where on the 18 Fireballs and Pyroblasts will call down a Meteor. And Sun King's Blessing, getting quite a bit of a buff, where only after 8 Hot Streak procs, your next non-instant Pyroblast within 15 seconds grants you combustion for 6 seconds. I remember that one being really good back in the alpha and beta, so I wonder if that one will actually come back into the spotlight in future. Frostmage has seen something similar to Fire, where it only takes 30 Frostbolts and Flurries to get your free Frozen Orb with Cold Front, and Freezing Winds will now give you, during your Frozen Orb, Fingers of Frost every 2 seconds instead of 3. Don't think it's gonna be that good for Frostmages, but I guess we'll have to wait and see. It could be maybe good for Cleaves. Then two non-spec specific legendaries are getting buffed. Disciplinary Command, where you cast Frost, Fire, and Arcane spells within 10 seconds, will increase your crit strike damage of spells by 20% instead of 15. And with expanded potential, on your Frostbolts, Fireballs, and Arcane Blasts, a higher chance to not get consumed if you end up using those procs for your damage and abilities. A bunch of legendaries for mages basically that don't really get a lot of play, but I guess Blizzard wanted to buff them for potential future playstyles. Brewmaster Monks have saw some buffs with Mighty Pour, giving Purifying Brew a higher chance to not consume a charge, and Celestial Brew grants you a whole lot of armor for slightly longer duration. Xiao Hao's Might, Tiger Palm has a higher chance to deal a bit more damage and reduce the remaining cooldown of your brews by 2 additional seconds. Then you have Clouded Focus, which will actually do a little bit more healing and reduce mana cost of abilities that you will use for spam healing allies just a little bit more. Combined together with the earlier we talked about Mist River abilities having their mana cost reduced, maybe that could be a potentially powerful combo. Maybe Clouded Focus could be a legendary more monks will be running in the future, who knows. And we also saw Zoan's battle gear getting slightly changed, where Rising Sun Kick crits will now reduce Fist of Fury cooldown by 5 seconds instead of 2.5. But still, Fist of Fury will only grant Rising Sun Kick 30% increased crit chance. Maybe we could see potentially a crit build for monks in the future? For Holy Paladins, we have Inflorescence of the Sunwell, where Infusion of Light has an additional charge and its effects increase by 30% instead of 20. And Shadowbreaker Dawn of the Sun, having its duration increased to 10 seconds instead of 6. Two legendaries that kinda sorta not really get too much play. For Protection Paladin, the Ardent Protector Sanctum legendary has actually been redesigned, where Ardent Protector now saves you from death, it will restore a lot of health. That effect is kind of okay, but the other one is a lot more interesting. When Ardent Defender expires without saving you from death, it reduces its cooldown to 60 seconds. And there's apparently conduits as well as other playstyles you can play as a Protection Paladin where you can further reduce the cooldown of this legendary. So if those conduits and talents work properly, you could have a very, very short cooldown of Ardent Defender as long as it doesn't actually save you from death. And that's a pretty nice, often used 20% damage reduction for your prop pally in the future. For Retribution Paladins, Vanguard Momentum now gives you slightly more holy damage for 10 seconds stacking, but it doesn't really seem like a very powerful legendary for Retribution Paladins. They also buffed Of Dusk and Dawn a little bit, where damage and healing component increased to 12 second duration, and damage taken reduced by 4% for 12 seconds instead. For Priest, we got some buffs and nerfs to the Holy Priest. With Flash Concentration, looks like they actually have a 20 second duration for this one. Has that one always had a 20 second duration? It looks like in tooltip it didn't, but maybe in game it did. Still, you have to get a max level priest in the game, so it's not like I can really test this legendary, but if it didn't have a 20 second duration, it does now. For Shadow, Painbreaker Psalm is now going to give you extra bit of sanity, but I don't know if it's going to be all that good. And then Shadow Flame Prism is going to make your pet do slightly more damage, but I wonder if that'll make a pet heavy build a thing in the future. Then we got a lot of rogue changes, and I'll make a separate video talking about more in-depth rogue updates for 9.02. But know this, Doomblade is getting quite a bit of a single target buff, and Dustwalker's patch will allow you to get more Vendettas out. For Outlaw, Green Skin's legendary is going to make your pistol shot hit a little bit harder, and Gauss Charm has a maximum 15% damage increase, where you go from 5% to 10% to 15% over time. Then you have Subtlety with the Rotten, increasing your backstab as well as Shadow Strike and Gloomblade damage by 50% instead of 30%. Nice buff there. Deathly Shadows also got a buff, depending if you are Subtlety or other specs. If you are the other specs, you gain a 50% damage buff, but for Subtlety, it's 20 for 15 seconds. I guess they wanted to make this Deathly Shadows more of a Subtlety-focused legendary. Also, Tiny Toxiblade went from making your ship do 350% more damage to 500. Could potentially be good, kind of a weird legendary, but maybe it'll be useful for Assassination. For Shaman's Elemental Variety, Echoes of Great Sundering has been nerfed. However, Earthquake damage has been buffed. So maybe it'll kind of balance each other out, where this can still be a good AoE legendary, or maybe it'll make it less good because Earthquake now does more damage baseline. I guess we'll just have to find out and see in the future if this is gonna sim any good. Legacy of the Frost Switch now does double the damage for your Storm Strike, so that could be pretty good maybe in the future. And they increased the value of the Chain Heal and Healing Wave mana cost reduction of Spirit Walker's Tidal Totem to 40% mana reduction instead of 25%. Couple legendaries for the Warlocks with Malefic Wrath, increasing your Shadow Ball damage by 35 for 10 seconds, stacking up to 3 times. And Wrath of Consumption giving you 6% damage buff for 30 seconds instead of 5% for 20. Maybe potentially making those a little bit better for Affliction. Demonology's Bale Spider's Burning Core increases your Demon Ball damage by 15% stacking for 20 seconds. Grim Inquisitor's Call increases the Felt Puppy's damage just a little bit more from Hand of Gul'dan's, and Implosive Potential buff will now stay with you for 4 seconds longer in order to make that Haze buff, I guess, a little bit more lucrative. For Destro, Madness of the Azhakir, at least I think that's what it's called, is now going to extend the buff by 1 extra second, so maybe, just maybe, you might be able to sling in more Chaos Bolts back to back, rapid firing them with massive destruction potential at your enemy. Then we have a couple changes to Warriors and their legendaries. Legendary for Arms, Battlelord. Your Overpower has a 40% chance to reset the cooldown of Mortal Strike, reducing its rage cost from Mortal Strike by 15. That's actually a pretty good one, since Slam is an ability used regularly. You use more overpowers, really, so that should synergize into that playstyle a little bit better. Enduring Blow makes your Mortal Strike a higher chance to apply Colossus Smash for a slightly longer duration. It's still a percentage chance proc, but maybe could be good. An Exploiter, Execute will now make your target deal 50% more damage for your Mortal Strike stack up to 2 times, which could give that Execute Mortal Strike playstyle, maybe as a Venti with Condemn, maybe make it a little bit stronger. Couple changes to Fury Warrior legendaries, mostly with the procs and stats. For example, Cadence of Fujieda, I guess? Bloodthirst now will have a longer duration of that Haze buff. Reckless Defense has gotten changed. Rampage Strikes, not Critical Strikes, have a 20% chance to reduce the main cooldown of your Recklesses and Rage by 1 second. Since they're not based off of crits, hopefully it'll make that ability and that legendary a lot more consistent. Will of the Berserker now has a longer duration, so it actually might be possible to maintain Will of the Berserker after Recklesses for a while, as long as you are lucky with those Raging Blows and can juggle this buff quite well. For Protection Warrior, we have Reprisal, where Charge and Intervene will now grant you Shield Block, Revenge, and generate 20 Rage. I talked to a Prot Warrior friend of mine. He said this is probably not going to be a legendary you'll want to prioritize into. Might have some niche situations, but it'll be a great supporting Lego if we ever get to the point where we can wear 2 Legos instead of 1. Finally, we have Unbreakable Will, where Shield Wall grants an extra charge, so 2 Shield Walls could be huge, and grants 50% of its effect to party members, which could potentially make this legendary better for 5-man content, or maybe in certain raids if you have your parties shuffled up in the right way inside of a raid, because that could be a pretty big damage decrease for your allies, and the second charge of Shield Wall could be good. But again, talked to a warrior friend of mine, he said, again, could be a decent secondary legendary. And that's going to be a lot of the changes we have right now for 905. There's most likely going to be a lot more, but I wanted to make sure to make this video covering all the legendaries, class changes, and covenant changes that have happened recently. Sorry, it's a long video, but there's a lot of stuff for us to talk about, and with BlizzCon on the horizon, I'm going to be swamped with so many videos to make, especially after all the BlizzCon announcements. But thank you guys so much for checking out this video. You let me know in the comments what you think about all these changes and updates. Which ones are your favorite and which ones you like and which ones you don't? Do you think any of the legendary changes we've had so far are going to potentially make some interesting builds? I would really like to hear from you guys in the comments if you think any of those have potential in that regard. Thank you so much for watching. Hope you enjoyed. And as always, I'll see all of you in another one.